So, myself and Carl, and so we had the opportunity to get back into the concession stand itself. And while last we met, there was discussions about what we needed to do to get it upgraded, not only for it to meet, become a known building to the powers to be up at SED, but also to utilize the building as a true concession stand with the to meet the Suffolk County Health Department requirements. So we were able to get back into the building with the assistance of Anthony over there. And we walked the buildings along with the press box as well. So the concession stand, I think we shared with the board a list of the requirements a number of meetings ago, I think it was, as to what the Suffolk County Health Department would require you and the various types of utilizations. And I think at the last meeting that we had, the board decided that they wanted to utilize it as a quote, man fence. And there was a breakdown of what would be required, what that entailed, and how that would operate. So I don't know. I think everybody had that list. We could go over that again, but there was certain criteria. So when we went back to look at the concession stand, we had that in our minds as to what would be required and what would be needed to be upgraded. So in front of you, we've kind of summarized. I think the first page of this document talks about what would be required to make that happen. So we can just kind of go line by line. And then we discuss what we thought the cost relative to that though. So the first is you're gonna see there are some demolition work that is required. The LP tank needs to be removed. There's disconnects that are required to be done to all the equipment. The sink needs to be removed. That's existing there now. The stove and the hot water heater in there. We know, because we've been talking about this for quite some time, that we need to do a sewer connection building and all your buildings are on sewer now. There is no sewer connection there now. So we would need to make that sewer connection. I think the document that follows shows where the sewer connection would need to be made. A number of maybe 2 or 3 years ago, going back now, there was some investigative work. There were other two different contractors that we had called in to give us some budgetary estimates to do that work. So we knew kind of where we were headed just to do the sewer connection. And that's reflected in this number. So that baseline number that you see at the bottom is really only to get the sewer connection, not to really do anything with the pavement back there other than the track. And I think, you know, we can talk about that pavement in a little bit because I know that that was an area of concern the board had, that pavement area back there is kind of in disrepair. So the existing system, albeit as small as it is, the existing sanitary system that there needs to be abandoned. So we're listing all of that out. Then we kind of get into the new work, what needs to happen so that you guys can operate it according to Suffolk County Health Department. And that would be that you need a hand sink and you need a mop sink in there. So there would be no new items. And of course that would have new plumbing and piping and sanitary connections connecting it to the sewer. We would need to upgrade the electric service that's there now. And primarily the electric service upgrade is because of the convection oven and the amount of power that would require. You're required to have a convection oven to be as man bending. And that power is now being fed from the press box. So we would need to run a new service from the press box back to the concession. The existing service there now is only a session stand. It's 100 amps, and we would have to upgrade it.
Sort of. and you probably were going to answer this, but I'll answer this in advance. So if, just saying, we said we weren't going to fix that press box, would you still be able to use that electric?
Yes, I'm sure.
Even if it's getting down and there's a press box.
Yeah, I think we could get into that discussion. I think you'd probably utilize it as storage.
Use the press box as storage, and then where would the press box be in the bleachers?
If that would be the route you want. We assume, you know, that's part of our, I guess, our discussion today, right? So just going down the list, so then you're required to have a floor drain in the concession stand for maybe obvious reasons, but for cleanup, et cetera, and then, of course, that's get connected to the sewer again. The press box, I mean, concession stand has an open ceiling. According to the code, the fire code requirements, you need to close that ceiling in, so we're making reference to that. We need to put some chipboard on there to fire rate that. It is required to have classroom function, which is like a door handle that's always openable from the inside for egress. So I'm making mention that the door handle and the doors need to get replaced. And it actually, believe it or not, needs to be handicap accessible. You need to be able to get in there with a wheelchair and exclude people from being able to be into that space and turn around and make a proper turn radius. So we're identifying that. And then there is a requirement from the Suffolk County Health Department that you need to have a dumpster within a close proximity of that box. So generally speaking, it's 10-foot by 10 space. Add and normally see a fancy. So all that put together with all those updates that would be required. And of course, all these numbers are fully loaded, like we always talk about, right? You know, has all your escalation contingency monies, fees, soft costs, et cetera. And people are looking at $695,000. And based upon prevailing wage. That would require you to go and get a permit from Suffolk County Health Department, Sewer District, as well as State Education Hall. At least three permits that would be required.
What would the cost be to knock it down?
I would venture say probably not $695,000. I would say it's not going to be $695,000.
But then to replace it, it would be cheaper to knock it down and replace it.
Not by a long shot.
And then we would not have a concession. So the second page, right, if you want to go into the next step there, which is addresses exactly Sam's question, right?
That any work that's done on that press box, the current concession stand, would we need variances from the, because it's kind of close to the people behind, right?
No, because you are a school district, we hope that you guys are really good neighbors, but you really have no restriction in terms of property lines or anything like that. Nature. So to answer your question, if you'd like to build a new one, the dollar amount is on the second page of your document. It's everybody sitting down.
$1.6 million for it.
So that number is based on a similar project that we did in Islip. There was something in the packet.
Everybody
can see the picture. Yeah. I'll pull it up on the screen as well.
There we go.
I think there was a floor plan that we
Do you want to talk a little bit about it first? Just asking, because that number is my model. That 1.6, would that include a bathroom?
Yes. So, it's based upon the ISLIP model. And I don't hope everybody got this in their pack.
All right.
So typically, this is kind of basic layout that's been utilized in the past, and you'll see that there's actually two boiler facilities in that plan, okay, both handicap accessible, and then a small concession pipe. And for obvious reasons, I mean, what the number that we based it on was not placing it back in the same location, because then we would have the demolition and all that. This was placing it closer. If you look at your packet, going back to this one now. You notice we have the note that places the concession stand a little bit closer to, I guess it would be the west end of the bleachers, a little closer to
the other side of the bleachers.
And it would get you a little closer for the run for the sanitary, but obviously there's it falls to everything, right? You just have to run water out there, you run electric out there, you have to redo the site work, you have to do walks to it, you know. So in today's marketplace, this is the number that we're seeing, you know, soup to nuts, ground up concession stand.
It would be on the other exact opposite end of where it is now.
Yeah, because you had the space there, got it closer to where you would do the physical tie-in sanitary. In my mind, that's putting closer to the beaches, which is where we normally see it.
I had a question on the layout of the new one. Why would we not put the doors for the bathrooms on the opposite side of the concession window? So if you're online for concessions, then you have whatever you have, noise, just even the crowd. You now have three lines of those.
This is like a basic
plan. Okay, that's my question. Yeah,
you have flexibility to manipulate the plan, you know, within the box.
Okay.
What I
thought of was if you're facing the field, for visibility reasons, you know, when that's locked at night, you know, the doors would probably be better off facing the building where it's lit. You can see cameras back there as well, just for security reasons. So this is kind of just about
yeah. I mean, you have, you know, this is kind of a, as you can see, it was from public restroom company, right? So this is the company that actually manufactured these prefab setups, but they have flexibility in terms of the size and footprint. And what you want to add, this one was. You know, a smaller size concession, as you can see, actual footage.
Works out nicely. I live in Iceland, go to the school football games all the time. It's comparatively to going to those games a few years before they had that.
Yeah.
It was a real hassle. You had to go into the high school to use the facilities, you know, that kind of thing. There was no food whatsoever.
I had a question, like the two concessions. I remember talking about rebuilding other concessions, like they were limited with what kind of food that you could sell. Are all concessions limited with what you can sell?
Oh, yes.
This is, you can only reheat things, I believe, right?
Yeah.
It's not a cooking.
Yeah, for bulk. But this is, the other one has the same title. One of these families.
So the name rolls for all
of them. And when you get heat out
there. Carolisa, there are electric hot dog programs. Those would be acceptable?
I believe so.
Because it's electric.
This is figured with the convention of to be in the space. And the idea being you're buying frozen food and stay in there.
I'm
not
cooking. I'm not making lasagna.
Yeah, exactly. You're not producing kitchen waste, like greasy kitchen waste.
Right. Okay.
There's no gas run to the building, things like that.
And that brings up a good point. No heat.
Yeah.
There would be no heat.
No, there isn't there.
Not even though they're.
Yeah, that brings up a good point. And, you know, a lot, most of this should fill rain with water. You know, there won't be any heat there.
You can't put electric heat.
You can.
It's costly.
It's typically not all that costly, but it fills the use of your existing electric.
They don't need
them. Most districts do not ask us what we
do. No.
There have been a few exceptions.
I've been to Iceland. They don't have
That's really cool.
It's all right. We don't play sports outside.
Thank
you.
Well, the pool will be pretty.
Sure.
Okay.
We'll never think it's not.
So again, just for everyone, right? Like we're gonna hear all the. And by the way, now we're gonna continue to try to press box. But if a question pops up about concession stand, just throw it back out there, right? You know, in terms of sort of in big Carl and Carol Lisa Crane. At the end of tonight, we're not looking for a decision, right? Because we have two other meetings that we're going to be talking about facility agreement. Again, there are a lot of facility things, right, in terms of the district. So.
I know
There was one question. The 1.6 million?
Yes, yeah. Basically what you're seeing now.
Yeah.
Be quite honest with you, that press box, the number that I gave is basically that press box.
It's bigger because of the bathrooms being added, basically. Concession space is not bigger.
It's not, it's a triple sink, a bucket sink, a hand sink.
Only a triple sink.
You don't need the hand.
And that's a big mistake. That's
I'm sorry, man.
Why are you being putting bathrooms in there if it's not really necessary?
So, a lot of districts, like, if they're going to.
Yeah,
so
that's kind of what I was trying to ask. Why are you just?
You don't have to.
It's your dime.
That's okay.
Gets the number in your head. It gets the number. What is just a bathroom washing?
But see, the issue is they still have to connect to the sewer. So you're going to, it's the reduction in the square footage. So, you know, we can come back to the board with that.
Yeah,
I really wanted to look at that.
Yeah.
We gave you the highest end because most districts that do it, they to themselves, okay, well, like what Carl was saying, okay, well, now we don't have to open up the building, have staff utilize the bathroom facilities inside the building, go for the John's extra. But we can certainly come back to the board and if you'd like us to. But, you know, that would be.
The ask basically what would be the cost of a new concession stand without the two? We're still looking at a minimum at least $695, right? Because I can't imagine it'd be $600,000 for that, or actually $1 million for the bathroom, right?
It might be, you know, it's gonna definitely be not less than the $695 because
right.
Remember, depending on where they're gonna put this, right? Still needs a new water service, right? Wherever the house is itself. It still needs a new electric service, no matter what. It still needs to have the connection to the sanitary. You're going to need more site work. Right?
The foundation, the structure.
But even without having sewage, like a toilet bowl and that, we still need to connect to the sewage system just for a sink.
Yeah.
And you're like,
yeah.
Well,
even though we're sick.
That is insane. This pressing that could have to the source.
I don't think there was a time I met with Suffolk County Board, and the guy told us they would give us a variance for settlement. But now that has gone. There's no option anymore for that.
Yeah, that's your fight to have the Suffolk County Health Department.
But that, I met with the head of Suffolk County Health Department people won't be in contact with him. And he said they would give us a variance. But then Roger said, you know, blah, 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 and we didn't go with it. We should have, because then we probably wouldn't have grant all the again. But now, no. But we're still legal if we do not do the toilet facilities because we are close enough to the building.
Yeah, it's also it's the footage from the concession stand itself to your facility.
Oh, well, we won't be if the concession building's on the other end.
So as I was looking at it, I looked into that because you have the locker rooms right there. So it's, I think you're pretty close to being the same.
Right, it wouldn't be the other bathrooms. It would be the bathrooms.
It would be in the bathrooms by the cafeteria. It would be the bathrooms by the gymnasium.
But one way or the other,
you'd have to open. One
or the other, we have.
So I still used to do that.
So if the athletes are using the locker room, right, so if the school's open already, anyway, theoretically,
yeah. Yeah, but currently, right now, You don't go in there, you step, you don't share. Like, I don't go into the bathroom with 16 kids in the
pocket. No, but I guess what my question was.
But you wouldn't be allowed to do that if you were in the concession stand. That locker room would have to be at bed, because that's the distance.
Right. You can't open
it. You could open the other one, but legally, we have to be able to go into the locker room.
Like, right now, the current concession stand and the bathrooms are open. We just made it. Do you remember? I mean, a number of years ago, we went in, like, we just made it with a. So it's going to be pretty similar,
but we would be knocking down that other building.
No, could we use it as storage?
All the shelf coach stuff is talking about the especially the handshakes, the roofing, and everything. Is that all before you bought a shelf, a cooked food, like a hot dog? If we did anything other than the hot dog, let's just say we don't sell hot food at all. We just want to sell eggs, chips, pretzels. We don't want to sell hot food. Then we don't have any extra stuff.
We need to build it with wood.
No, I'm saying I have one of the heavy shelf stuff. Right, if we just sell chips,
you can sell some
stuff. Okay, but if you want to,
you don't have a concession stand.
$699,000
That's insane.
I'm sorry.
There are other people who want to rent it. Like that, we're thinking just school events. There are people who come to our meeting and want to pay us to use that position. So we're not going to get people to pay us money to sell them the family.
But people are going to, who's going to pay us to use our concession?
Any club, anybody who does anything in the field, that can pay us. That's the policy that you just gave.
But are they actually going to pay us to think about what
they're
going to pay?
That's
what
we do.
It costs us money to shut it down also. Like, we have to cut the water, like, everything has to show up, right? Wasn't it something in there that we didn't have?
Not really.
You know, just something. Well, wasn't it worth money for me? No,
well,
you just closed it up and didn't
answer
for anything. Wouldn't go
on.
I said we had
to
like turn off the water and everything.
Well, you don't have to do much.
I thought that the first thing that doesn't have so I know, but I thought when you came it said to abandon.
So there were.
So we had done.
There were a few options, right?
Right. And in the very beginning. We went through different options of if you wanted only sell chips, if you were right, like out of all those scenarios, right? If you only wanted in storage building, then you would still need to do a couple, like I think, from the right line. Right. So from those, then ultimately, then I had asked the board for direction on which one we wanted to dive deeper into, and the direction was my people on the football right through. Right. So, yes, to do like the basic, like, let's say just storage, there's some kind of basic thing that we're going to do, or like I want to do here. If you wanted to sell tickets out of there again, there's some things that we're going to need to do the rest of the year.
Yeah. Is that field ever rented out for events?
In field. I know that there was a nice little one that ran track, but
all the districts coming over. Right. That's the big event. Flag football, yeah. We talked about, we have that as well. Right. And there's a couple other organizations that ran the field.
Listen, it would take us probably 15 years to recoup the chunk of what it's going to cost. Then you have to look at it. I see this as community service. You know, we didn't open this season, and people were so upset that they couldn't buy, they get a hot dog, a soda, or a pretzel. I mean, we never sold much more than that. And as far as selling chips, John, I'm doing this a long time, and I have a sign made that we've given over $105,000 in scholarships. You can't give scholarships, just sell chips, you know.
If the school's going to spend this kind of money, that this is going to have to be a legit. I'm not saying that I'm a legit. It's going to have to be a register. It's going to have to be a document. How much we're bringing it. We have so many. We spent this kind of money, and this is what we're bringing.
No. This is not a school making money. These are organizations. If I use it during football season, I don't have to tell you how much I'm making.
With an organization, I'm going to shoot yours, but you said yours. Shouldn't have that. Use it. Years in advance, we just changed the policy on purpose. And now, I mean, I don't know what we made.
What does that policy say?
The policy says that if the people in your organization aren't 50%, or I think it's been changed to 75%.
Well, I was opening during the community, I would say 90%.
No, it's not about the people who show up, it's not the people who are there. If Deer Park showed up here today and said, hey, I want to use your concession stand, but most of the people, most of the customers, we must have one, we would charge Deer Park. We would say, yeah, no problem.
But using my organization. If the track club wanted to use that building,
that's different. Though. That's
why
that's,
is that different?
That's a district. That's an internal district.
If they have evening events that are not school.
Doesn't matter. They have more than 75% of that one. But
I don't think hurt that, right? What like, organization?
I don't know.
That's a bad example.
Comparing apples and oranges. I think when we're looking at a new structure, we're opening it to other organizations. I don't know if that's always been the case with the current. Current structure.
Yes.
My next question would be, well, who else has used it? And what we should do is look at, as an example, on a new structure, there would be a fee. If the XYZ soccer league wanted to use our field, sure, you can use our field, here's the fee. If you'd like to generate for your club out of our concession stand, there's an additional fee.
Right.
And if the bathroom's attached, something it would be marketed more as
if it's not really the concession stand. I don't know if it could be when people who are not some sort of soccer use it, they have to pay for but it doesn't matter if it's 200% by Babylon.
Right.
If people who are non sound short soccer, whether it be travel soccer teams or Susan soccer, if they use those fields, they have to pay. I would senior clients from homecoming and say, hey, call the general company. How much money do they make at homecoming? And that's the money that we could have given right to our senior clients. And I understand where you're coming from because I look at it like there's a lot of money too, but easily 10 grand that night. I mean, I was there, four ice creams in, five sandwiches.
The
Want the trucks and they were
so any
So I think too close. So I think all of that actually there was a right. So funding from them went to the group that organized that night. Right, the school district, right?
I'm only getting prepared. I'm positive that there's no gyro truck on Long Island, but we put moving in 100% profits.
Right.
So we had a concession stand, and then let's say they did $10,000. That's $10,000 that would go right to school, or $8,000, whatever it may be. And that was what I was trying to say. We have those numbers, and I'm trying to work with John. We have the numbers how much you'll invest in bulk for our in school lessons, our senior class, our track team, football, wherever it may be. We actually
have that problem. They pay a lot. Those trucks charge a lot.
Oh, I know. We don't know the details. Yeah. Eddie comes and he makes $5,000, gives $1,000 check. No. So that's my point. We definitely have the ability to pay money.
The only difference is I'm going to use my organization.
Right.
All our money goes to scholarships, you know, and we give scholarships, not just to the football players, you know, so that's a little bit different.
I think personally it's a different conversation because I'm with John on that. Like, I do have a local organization. I pay for my permit to use that.
I'm not saying we should pay.
But what I'm saying is I'm kind of like, I'm. Because you were a twofold on that, you're like, well, you know, organizations are going back to the district should pay. Then John's like, then we should know how much you pay.
I never said organizations that you get back should know.
I think that's how it should be. I think that this is something that we could have.
It should be then a flat fee.
Yeah, right.
You know, and if you are a West Babylon organization, yeah, you pay X amount of dollars,
yeah,
and then you're outside. So now here's the cap, Lisa. Then in that building will be the district's refrigerator, the district's stove, everything of mine comes out, and then I'll sell it. You know, so that will
work because out. All of this would be heated.
Right.
But everything that's already there,
it's mine. Mine would not be mine, the organization. But we would put a refrigerator in there for people to sell soda and an electric, hydro roller or the oven section of it.
Oh, so this doesn't include the equipment?
The biggest appliance
that
we
use
is that. Well,
Those things are a state account. $50,000.
We never had to do that. We had pretzel warmers, we had all these things that we could plug in, but not less than $50,000. That's great. And you know what? Everybody with $50,000 other than great speaking, or at least $15,000. That's what I'm saying. Like, they have the money to them. Yeah. You can't cook even if you have an oven. I think most people think of an oven. I mean, we do pretzels in here, but that's. And just as an aside, I could still get a permit from the town of Babylon to do an outside event and have barbecues outside and do my hot dogs on the grills outside. So I don't think.
Well,
And then
it'll last financial. You know, we used in the ground, we had those camping things before we built this building. We could have pots on the ground.
Anybody can do that.
Any organization can do that. Yeah, regardless of it comes in. Well, they're not fully discussed, right? Like, they're definitely, there's a pathway to organizations to be okay, right? With the appropriate permits for them to sell. Different things,
right? Because if we do the one that involves the bathroom and whatnot,
kind of piggybacking on what Matt was saying about you charge the organization. Let's say an organization comes in and says they only want the bathroom accessibility and not the concession, that we would just have a different fee.
Like if you build a new one?
Yeah, so if an organization says they just want the bathroom right there, the convenience of it being right there.
I think that would really come with a permit. I mean, I don't think on a permit
request.
I don't know if we would say, oh, you're paying for the field and then go ahead.
We'll circle back around those two questions, right? The cost of a new concession stand without the bathrooms, and also what are we currently paying for the
portable bathrooms, right? Can I ask my other question?
Sure. Yes.
On here, there's a list number A for the asphalt, and then I'm looking at the picture. If you can break up the whole school picture, like marked in red. I think they're called drones now, Prince. There we go. So that red marking, I thought that when we were back there, and maybe I was wrong, but I thought the plan, instead of repaving that, was to reimagine it.
Yeah, so this is purely trust. I needed Carolee to give, you know, kind of apples to apples numbers, right? Like, so without kind of adding another layer of redesigning it, which we haven't talked about which way we want to do that, right? Just the concept of, obviously, if we had to rip up to do the sewer line basic level, then obviously we're not just going to patch up the area that was cut up. It would need to be redone, right? So just to get a number on that, just apples to apples. So yes, you are right, Matt, that, you know, we talked about during our walkthrough, right, that when we address that back area, it's really, you know, the perfect time, right, to be able to look at it and see if we want to then redesign that back area. But that doesn't, this doesn't account for that.
We just have to think ahead and think we decide now. How, you know, even if there's ideas you have that are 5 years down the line or however long they may be, take that consideration.
Right, exactly.
Obviously not open to having it more.
No, I mean, listen, and that's why, you know, we get three workshops that we're going to go through a lot of facilities.
Yeah.
Right, like, so, you know, at the end of this, and all of these have these types of numbers, right? So we are going to need to prioritize, and it will be a multi-year plan, right? And as much as it turns my stomach to say, some of these may not be the first two, right? Like, with the things that happen, all of it, we certainly, of course, want all of it to happen. But when it does, right, you know, addressing those at the same time, you know, obviously makes a good one.
Would we consider going out with a small capital project to do facilities?
Well, let's hold that conversation
for the next thing for the roof. Really doesn't have anything. So if you went out with a couple $1 million facility project, you get to pay it off in 30 years. You know, 65% aid on it. We make something in the classroom. Can we do the press talk? We have the photography class still up there.
So before we get into in terms of the how, right, let's continue on kind of going through all the topics, right? That
keep that in your minds to think about a little bit.
Press box.
Okay, press box. So Again, this is the building that certainly needs some help. Obviously the health department doesn't get involved in this, but it's all obviously state education department permitting agency. So again, we went back through what you would be required, what their requirements are to utilize that building as a press box. I'll go down through the list. And obviously, as some of the photos show, there's issues with the roof, there's issues with the guardrails, there's issues with the egressing, there's issues with the block walls that have substantial mortar issues, and looks like there's water infiltration. There was very apparent water infiltration. So this addresses the entire building. What would we need to do to address it on the floor? Various things required. Because it doesn't serve food, and really the bathroom, the concession, the twofold, it's required by the county health department that people that work in the concession stand are required to have a bathroom facility, a changing facility. And that's the real, if you really read the Suffolk County Health Code, that's the impetus to why you need the bathroom in close proximity to the concession stand. Just so everybody knows, State Education Department has not only follows New York State Building Code, but they also have their own code. So when you see me reference MPS, that's called the Manual Planning Standards. That's a document that's put out by the State Education Department. It's kind of, for lack of a better word, a rider to the New York State Code, right? So we all have to adhere to the New York State Building Code, but SCD or State Education Department also has what they call their many standards, which is kind of an enhancement to it, written more specific to public schools and the various requirements that they look for. So, as a matter of fact, also, I did make some contacts to some of the reviewers of the State Education Department because they are now coming out after 20 some odd years with a new manual planning standards. And as luck would have it, it's going to come out, I think, at the end of the beginning of April. So this is, you may have seen write-ups from myself in years past in prior DCS reports that referenced it, and they did make some changes. So this new document reflects the newer code, as we would assume that if you were to proceed with anything, it would happen after April 1st. So, you are allowed to have wood construction. In years past, you were not allowed. You wanted to access the roof. So this is a new change for them. So I'm describing that we still need to fire rate that construction. Yeah, well, yeah, the inside picture, you saw the wood framing there. Still need to do something with that, but you are allowed now to utilize the roof if you wanted to use the roof as a viewing station. You have to replace that roof because it's pretty in bad shape. So we've included a price to do that. The guardrail is not to code that's up there now. So you have to replace that guardrail. It has to be a two code, 42 inch high guardrail, and have to have all the barred balusters so no one falls through. I'm again talking about repairing the CMU walls with photos. You see a lot of water. You see all the gaps in the mortar. That's just a block wall that's just been painted to stop elements of water coming through. So the mortar is deteriorated, there's water infiltration coming through all the block walls. So in the number that you're seeing, I'm recommending that we repair and repoint the mortar, all the block walls, as well as put some sort of a more substantial waterproofing membrane on the outside. There are some coatings that are out there. I'm not budgeting at the moment any kind of siding that goes over the block or anything that looking something of a membrane of membrane that acts as a finished product. The roof, the guardrails, you need to have an appropriate ladder that accesses from that second floor level. If you want to utilize the roof, they require you to have a a straight up ladder. They don't consider that to be safe, so they want you to have a ship ladder or, you know, handrails. It will require, if you want to utilize the lower bottom floor as storage, which we know we need to do something because there's electric panels, incoming electric that service the field there. We need to separate that out and make sure that you're not traversing through a storage facility that's requiring to have a 1 hour rating. So I'm talking in this dialogue about creating a little passage as you come down the staircase, independent door, right? Because in a case of emergency, you can't go and pull up an overhead door. Door was down, it's not legal for egress. Right? So you have to put a door to the outside. So the occupants are on the second floor, they have to come down the staircase, they get down to the door, and like a classroom setting door handle that allows for you to egress with a real door. So you'd be creating a little passageway there with a door to the outside.
Can't put a possible humidifier machine in that storage space. The lawnmowers, the tractors, that have got
that's why we're trying to create the 1 hour rated fire separation between whatever you, because obviously it's a large space. We would imagine that you'd like to continue to utilize it with some storage of that functionality, but we'd have to fire rate that properly. So we separate that function from the press fire function that would be happening on that upper floor and then the roof.
Or to abandon that press box and put a new one in the bleachers, could we still use that for storage? And we wouldn't have to do the floor upstairs because we wouldn't really be using upstairs.
Right.
We'd be
not
using
people up there.
We're not putting people up there. We could use it for storage.
Yeah, and you would still need to document it as a building,
right?
With SCD, so you still have to go up there. Probably could do it as a. We would do it as a discovered building. It'd be a different.
You found. Somebody
planted. Yeah.
Yeah, you do the things that are necessary.
Yeah, you didn't want to put the membranes. And we didn't prevent the collapsing on them.
But okay. You know, and we would probably recommend that the overhead door be replaced with maybe something like what you have at the custodial entrance now that at least has some door mechanism. It's interesting because SCP requires, even when you put these storage pods, that you literally have to have an egressable door, ventilation, in case somebody actually said it. So there might be a limited amount, you know, it wouldn't be to the degree, obviously. But yeah, you'd probably have to have a door or some sort of thing.
So would it end up being less expensive to do what we need to do in there and put a new one up in the bleachers? Do you have numbers? I can't see any.
Not the next week.
So to answer your question, there would be a mixture of the monies, right, to do. So I have not evaluated what the cost would be to just turn that into a storage building, but we can do that. Right? What we did evaluate is if just setting that building aside, you know, and if we looked at number one, could a press box fit on the existing bleachers, which we have confirmed that it would fit, how much would that be? You put that in that platform area, that's at least a big bleacher area. That would be, we would estimate that to be 300,000.
How much is
350. That would be like a manufacturer. I'm sure you've seen them. We gave the sample again. My slip, I think we pick something kind of close in your backyard.
So it would still be cheaper to put the new one up there and fix that as a storage building. It wouldn't be more money.
That we'd have to look at, right? Okay. Because the value of but doing the new one versus the
building.
Things that you might have addressed in the storage building might be. No.
What about handicapped access to the second floor?
You're not required to do it, but you do need to provide they have what they require is what they call the ability for a walk. It's the same thing like a press box that you would have now on nature. There's no handicap accessibility required there, but they would require an access point that someone in a wheelchair can access a wireless control for the operation of the scoreboard, right, in a remote location. Okay. It's kind of an interesting dialogue. It does not have to be at the press box. And either in
sense. Okay. So it will together plastic converted to storage, right, and see what that looks like for the work.
Please come home with
another option. Obviously, I'm feeling this is. Potentially the direction we go, obviously, for that, just foreshadow a little bit. The only other option for that press, the current press box, would be to demolish it or convert it to storage.
Right. So that would be, and it would probably cost a lot of money to demolish it. Can you give us a number for that, Jim?
To demolish the existing
press box.
Remember, the problem is that the electric services and that services the fields.
It's servicing the field like
we couldn't relocate a service on a phone.
You can, but it will cost money.
Substantial.
It'll be a new service with exterior rated, you know, human 3R switch here or something. It's designed to be outside.
But
why wouldn't you keep it? It's a sword.
I can't imagine it would cost all this much money.
It's stupid to tear it down. It's just, you should know.
Or for it to be allowed to be stored, there are some repairs that have to take place, correct?
Yeah, we're trying to get the building tight, basically.
Right.
And add proper regress to it.
Right. So there was some things that have to be done.
Yeah.
It's going to stay there. There's some things that have to be done. No, we can't.
Then you can.
If we make those repairs, yeah.
But we could
do. Oh, there's some repairs.
Yeah, you can only do that if you're not going to have people in there.
So there's two different prices.
It's not really two prices.
Yeah, I don't think. Would you want to have one always stored
there?
We have another
one. Oh, they're all.
The circle itself, or the bleachers, that's where the one the circle is. That's the machine we need to talk about. It's
yes.
Yeah. Oh,
so it's probably pretty much an important today to build that one. Cool. Okay. And the other one is for it.
Oh, inverter.
Inverter to store.
Right.
So there's both sides.
Yeah, and you get to keep the, you know, the built-in storage.
Updated.
Plus, you don't want to knock our ego down.
So they just saw her, right? They mowed the turf field.
No, that's the truth.
The book is not it comes down to grow so much.
We do that all.
Well, during the season that you have just one to play speed, and especially during 4 games.
Okay.
All right. Transportation building. It's been an interesting process.
Yeah. Unless we left off for transportation and the crash one.
Right, so I have shared that we went to the wall this evening after being monitored, right, for those months, right, and what number is there. But the ground, exactly.
The
wall is going to be ground like
something. Exactly. The ground is going to be under. Right, stay away from
it. I heard the stream.
Yeah,
but that's your problem. You know, I don't think you want to start pulling the bus through here.
What is the solution?
So, okay, so where are we, right? So we're in, I guess we're in a okay spot. We know that the whatever movement has occurred over the past 15 years or so seems to have slowed. So as we discussed, we did have our structural engineer put the monitors on the wall, and we monitored that for 6 months, and we've seen no additional movement. So the belief is now that whatever has occurred, for whatever reason, has come to a halt. So now what to do, right? So effectively, in light of the fact that the soil we believe is not as good as it should be, and we are working on getting one final drawing. We discussed this earlier. And we'll know definitively after that. The belief is that really, because of the condition of the soil, that it would require that the building be on tiles. Now, we understand that this is a building that is not student occupied, but we want to do the right thing. So we started to explore some options that might be available, that might be a way in which could be a temporary fix, could be a temporary permanent fix, and still keep you operational without you having to explore doing something major to the building to or to build a new building. So in the past several weeks since we met, we have come up with some other thoughts about what might be able to be done. I have contacted the contractor that helped assisted us in opening up the slab so we could see underneath. We were doing our investigative work as well. Same contractor helped us do the test fit. And I've asked that contractor to go and give us some pricing on this potential new thought, which has been reviewed with the structural engineer. What they would do is, which has been a method that had been used in actually another school that actually had a very similar situation in Franklin Square, as a matter of fact. Now, the school building and the two wings where the slab actually had a crack along the outside wall. What it is you would be drilling holes through the slab because the soil below the slab is just let it lapse, so it's kind of dissipated. You would drill these holes and fill and pump and eject an epoxy graft underneath the slab. And it would help to take up the voids underneath the slab and stabilize. It wouldn't be to raise the slab now that it's dropped. It would try to stop any further movement. That along with removal of the floor, fill the holes, you're gonna have all this. And then it would be a self-leveling, try to get that back to a level point. So we wouldn't want to try to push that slab up too much. We're just trying to stop it from falling in. That would be a way to get the floor level again, hopefully stabilize it to a point where that floor would be. That does not address the exterior foundation. You know, that south wall. And that would be really where the piles would have to come in. We can't really do anything with that outside wall unless we put piles. There are methods to do piles nowadays that are not as, you know, for example, if you've gone over the beach, you see the big pile of fibers going down. They have lots of different methods now where it's actually not as invasive. It's a smaller machine. They go in toward the foundation wall from the outside wall generally, want to do it that way, and they would actually insert the pile right underneath the existing foundation that's there. And there's a lot of mechanism involved in it. You can maybe get just photos of it in operation. I just wouldn't be able to get any tonight's meeting where they insert the pile underneath the actual footing. And that would be a way to address it. So I think we might have a hybrid plan. And I'm waiting for a price, which I was hoping to have for tonight, which I do not have. But as soon as I have it, I hope we are, which would be a stopgap, which would be a lot less costly than to aggressively go after the entire building and attempt to get piles the entire perimeter. we would look to possibly do it just on the south wall, because that seems to be where your issues lie. If you go into that building, everything seems to have dropped along mostly that south wall. So I think that would be a good approach. So as soon as we have that number for you, that and then that would then allow you to continue to operate without having to move interior walls to try to get inside, do filings, because we know we have that north side where we have that other storage shed building and restricted with access in there. And I think that would be a good approach to see if we can give you some more longevity out of that building.
Self-leveling that floor so that crack would go away.
Exactly. Normally what they would do is they would take out the VCT, obviously, right? That would come out. The injection would go below the slab. You'll see like little holes, right? In the crack itself, normally they do another epoxy product that will hold the crack together. They self-level the whole floor. Drop this way, we can bring it back to level, and then we keep flooring or whatever you'd like on top.
How big is the difference between level and sink? How many inches?
It's probably dropped, I think, at least 2 inches.
Away from those offices?
Yeah. So if you were to walk in, there's a door on the east side and a door on the west side, effectively the southern end. That hole, and it's significantly worse in the southwest corner. But if you go into the gentleman's the director's office, you can feel that the floor is definitely pitched in toward the south wall as well. So something obviously happened to the soil underneath that that's creating that issue.
You said the wall on the foundation itself.
No, the wall is actually independent. The wall is on the foundation, yes.
The wall hasn't moved at all. So it's the same to say the wall hasn't moved at all. If the wall is on the wall and the wall has not moved, then the floor has to be able to
climb. So the wall and the floor are not on, the floor is not on the wall.
That's something I'm thinking works for on the foundation. No, two separate things. Versus foundation. Okay.
So it is conceivable that the slab could move independent of the wall.
That's not what I'm saying. If the wall has a floor, that means the wall has a floor.
So this
slab
that you're talking about, that's going to just described, right, is kind of a middle point, right, to what. If you wanted to share a little bit the details of the other plan, which would be much more involved, right? You know, in terms of the foundation, the outside and the inside, and obviously the cost for this is astronomical. So hence, not just in terms of the cost, right? But the brainstorming of what else could be done to resolve the issue that we have, right? Without doing all of this, right? And displacing us, right? In terms of transportation, not just that, but again, it's quite the process. If you can just share with the board a little bit that other solution.
Yeah, I mean, the more aggressive approach would be to put tiles along the entire perimeter, because the suspicion is, right, if it happened on one side, what's to prevent it from happening on the north side? Right? You haven't seen that yet. We just saw it because we could visually see the crack in the floor. We've seen the crack in the corner wall, right? It doesn't appear at this moment that it hasn't happened yet on the north. But if you are going to go and have machinery there, right, that's a decision that you need to make, right? Would it be appropriate to just leave half of it done? I don't want to put that thought into your head, but it's something to be thought about. So our first approach was, let's do it through the whole building. And that would mean that we have to somehow or another get tiles on that north wall. And you have a building that's next to me. Does that require it? There are methods in which they can actually bring the pile machine inside the building and do it from the inside. But that's more impactful, right? We have to now erect the slab. You can't get a pile under a footing if a slab is. So it becomes more of a larger project. In order to get the piles in there, the walls inside the building have to be removed. Get to the rest of the foundation wall, right? They're going to be in the way. So, you know.
When they put this epoxy under the building, do they shoot it under with the like the machine that they use for an underground electrical service?
Like construction sites, they have this thing with a giant hose that's pumping concrete.
I was just going to say, there's no way to pump concrete up
there. Well, that's what this material is.
Yeah, basically, that's what it's in
it. It's a slurry of some sort, and it's given its strength by not concrete, but by a pot. I would assume it's looser than concrete.
Yeah,
so where it needs to go.
Plus the larger stone, right? It's doing the entire building. And so the church is kind of like that, right?
So how long is the building?
I don't know.
Because Anthony gave it to me. This is one of my questions to Anthony. So I can pull it up as long as I've been around.
It's only about like 1600 square feet. It's very small. It's like a 32 by 32, something like that.
The board is going to receive all the information, right? So ultimately, for the same reason that you're, you know, highlighting now is, you know, why I turned back to Carolisa and I said, I can see in terms of that part of our discussion will be, let's address the problem that we immediately see right now, as opposed to in terms of the entire thing. While equally as important is the plan to do the whole thing, even though we don't know. So the board will receive all, right? Like the whole kit caboodle, and also, you know, this kind of midway plan, right? That we're soaring, and then ultimately, again, that'll be part of the decision, you know.
We
will need to develop plans to relocate them.
Oh, there's field equipment underneath it.
On the outside.
There's a document that I have that has all the square footages and stuff. I'll share. So, we have two other facilities meetings, which we're going to highlight and continue to talk about, obviously, you know, different structures, right, throughout our district, specifically utilizing the building condition survey, obviously, that, you know, Carolisa and BBS team, you know, put together, right, for us. That does include, you know, a number of areas that the board has already highlighted as priority areas for us, right, in particular behind the junior high school, right, that's included in there as well. So the next two meetings, we will go through those, go through our building condition survey, talk about those. You know, there are, approximate numbers associated with those as well, right? And then at the end of March, after we've gone through those meetings, then we have to kind of take a look at all of these documents that we have, right? And then we'll be talking about an action plan, multi-year plan, what are our priorities, and how should we take this?
When you get all of these numbers, I think maybe I would like Denise to, you know, take those numbers and look at a capital bond and what that, like, it comes down to $4 million. have Denise come up with, you know, what it would cost the taxpayers for a 15-year bond. Is that a difficult thing?
Yeah, I mean, we could, you know, let's kind of go through all these pieces because I think we also have to talk about the timing of all of it, right? And with this, you know, would it be a good idea to go out? You know, yeah, I think we have to kind of explore kind of all the movies. Obviously, we're going to be establishing a capital reserve, but there's a timing right. piece as well there, right? Once established, we're waiting for the following year.
I think we should focus on the capital reserve because part of the reason of the capital reserve is that we cannot get into the bond in the future.
Right.
And we're asking people to approve the capital reserve, which is not going to increase taxes, which is going to be coming into this revenue for other reserve areas in place. And then on the next part, we're saying, oh, we're going to have the capital on hold, which we're mentioning or exploring.
The timing of it may not work in terms of our budget. We just have to keep in mind that capital reserve, whatever number we establish, it's only going to be a certain amount of work. It's going to be a little bit of a cost for a capital fund. Go out and you could accomplish much more in 5 years than a capital reserve would allow us to do in 5 years. You know, we say $1 million.
You get much faster, right? My concern would then be now if we're trying to present another budget and we add another expense onto that.
We have to look at all the numbers and problems. As opposed to capital reserve, and see what we could do. I'm not saying we have to do it right now, but you know, I mean, obviously, this seems like it's a priority.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we'll go through because there are definitely a couple of other things in the building condition survey that I know that you will, you know, we would all agree that those are priority items as well, right? So that's why I don't want anyone to kind of think decision forward in terms of now. We'll go through the next two because again, there are a couple of other things, well, quite a number of things, but definitely a few that are going to come up, right? You know, as priority, right? Yeah, take a look at those. And then, you know, end of the month, and we'll talk about which ones, right, are our first 1 through 3, you know, and what timeline are we thinking, you know, with regards to those, and then we talk about if we're going to
generate numbers, is there a way to roughly predict if the capital reserve would be approved? Is there a way to generate some kind of a projection of how we can fund that currently we have? You know, in 3 years, we could potentially have this much.
Not necessarily
three years,
right? But I think probably Denise has done some work on it already, right? We're looking at maybe around $1 million on the establishment.
Okay.
You know, okay. So to project that in terms of year 2, year 3, you know, we wouldn't really be able to do
right.
If we're sticking with the concept of utilizing, you know, end of year fund balance, right? Kind of a couple of pieces and within that umbrella only, right?
You wouldn't be able to tell what this is going to cost in 3 years. No. So like there's no way for us to plan anything past what they hand us today. And the way that the world's right now, in 3 weeks, the numbers can come up.
Right. Oh, yeah, and things can levitate. You know, I mean, sorry, things can go down, come back to earth as well. I'm just curious. Is we know we can project what the expenses are going to be. Well, I think the most important thing we're going to decide is getting this capital reserve, just to see how much we can get into that reserve without creating more expenses.
Yeah, but I don't think they go together personally because you'll only be able to, you'll just know what you have. You won't know what you're going to spend because all these numbers are going to change. You're going to want to know. We're going to tell the community, hey, we're going to fix a junior high school because we know that it's terrible. And we say, hey, in 4 years, we'll have enough money. And then in 4 years, we come back and we don't have enough money. Now we look at
it. You just mentioned the first year. possible projection. You didn't know that information until that question was just asked. So we at least know, okay, that's a possibility. Now, as we go through these workshops, we can start to prioritize or clearly identify what is feasible to get done on the current money we have versus further discussion of taking out a bond. We can't prioritize it. We don't know what to get out of it.
I don't know, but if it looks like $1 million, you know, that's really nothing compared to, I mean, these are probably some of the smallest quotes that we'll see, I would imagine.
Yeah, I mean, we'll go through them. You know, I mean, that's one of the slides on our March 14th budget presentation. we'll go through those, but yeah, that is part of in terms of the mix, right? Because also keep in mind, we're establishing it. Unless we set up a separate vote in terms of utilizing it, right? It'll go with the same cycle then in terms of the following year. So initially, you know, in terms of the analysis with the auditors, it's something like about $1 million, right? In terms of utilizing, you know, pulling from current reserves. Yeah.
There's no way you ever stop.
No, definitely.
I think that's important.
And again, that's very tentative because that's based on the last 24 hours, you know, working in terms of.
So I have one more question. So even with that money, we have to get permission to spend it. So if the community wants a concession stand, we say, hey, our priority with our money is the, you know, the garage. The community can say no and just vote no, right? We need permission to use.
We need permission to establish a fund.
So it doesn't matter really how we could take every single thing and make a pretty list. And if the community says absolutely not, this is what we want first, they get what, and if we don't have enough money, then it's kind of like, okay, we
the community wait. Has to vote and have these creature pieces
take money out of the capital and reserve without capital reserve, our reserves.
So emergency,
in the non the bus garage.
That would be the one we call the capital.
Because I think $1 million is not going to be nearly enough.
I agree. I'm just saying, if our priority isn't, if we have to go and ask permission to use that money that we're discussing. So if our priority doesn't match the community's priority, then our priority really doesn't matter. You know, if we can say, hey, we're going to have $1 million, we want to get these three things done, we still have to ask to use that money. They come back and say, hey, we don't need the money.
So just to recap, the numbers coming back was going to be the concession stand minus the bathrooms, right?
Yeah.
And the structure minus the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
It was the cost to convert the press box to storage only.
Yes. Yeah.
And then the two quotes on the files for the garage, right?
The transportation building, the two different plans. Mm-hmm. Yep, definitely. And then I just have a side note piece for me to just take a look at how much we're spending on porta potties. Just, I think that was a question over here, so I have it. You were the person I said.
I believe
we did have some insurance kickback, you know, like in terms of afterwards because it fell under, right? Yep.
So your existing sewer line is actually, and where is
the right?
Sewer line on Willie Stack Road.
No, you don't connect there. You actually connect.
We can make a new connection to the town.
No, because you haven't. It runs and it runs to the back of your building, pretty much to the corner of the gymnasium right now.
Yeah, well, it's
So what's that right in front of that cafeteria? There's a storm drain right there.
Yeah, that's a storm drain though.
It wasn't a sewer in front of it.
So no. So it actually stops. I want to say at the corner of the gym. And that's where we need to connect. So we have to get from the concept. We can't have two connections. Right? We have to connect on the connection that's on site right now. So that's why we needed to go from the concession stand now or in that asphalt pavement area and then make the connection like on the corner of the gymnasium there.
Okay, so that wasn't we have to have two connections up on the bottom because we have
plus the pitch was also an issue.
Yeah.
But the pitch also the reason why the sewer line is so long. Because I asked that question, the way I think the same is that and the problem is the pitch
I don't know how many you might remember. We had a couple of contractors, one or two contractors come out and try to find where that connection was and got us our inverts so we could figure it out for you a couple of years ago.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions on these three topics? All right. We will save all of our documents. We will be in touch, Carolisa. And we will continue our facility discussions during our next workshop meeting, which I believe is next week, March 7th. March 7th. Thank you so much, everyone. Team in the back, thank you so much. All set.